Now this USB-C cable is pure perfection. I mean, with it I can power pretty much everything up to a maximum of 240 watts, which is the newest USB-C standard. It does that while featuring a way lower resistance than any other commercial USB-C cable, meaning it is super efficient, and that is what I care about the most. But you apparently don't care about that at all, because in the video in which I created this cable, there were tons of comments saying that a high-speed USB-C cable would have been more interesting. I mean, my DIY cable can also transfer data, but only with slow USB 2.0 speeds. And even worse, as time went on, more and more data transfers using my cable simply stopped, or did not work at all. So what is going on here? Well, in this video, let's uncover this data transfer mystery and try to create our own high-speed USB-C cable. Let's get started! This video is sponsored by Mel Science, which is a subscription service that offers monthly science boxes like these. I got the heat transfer and magnetic levitation kits, whose physical principles are of course important to electronics as well. For example, when it comes to redesigning the heatsink system of a projector, like I did in a previous video. With Mel Science, however, you can get to know the basics of not only physics principles, but also chemistry, STEM, and more. There is something for every age group, and playing around with these kits and learning something along the way makes science definitely more approachable and fun for everyone. So if you're interested in trying these kits yourself, then you can click the link in the video description and use coupon code SCOTT50 to get 50% off your first monthly box. Now let's get started with my DIY USB-C cable and why even slow data transfer does not seem to work anymore. To get behind this, I firstly created a shorter USB-C cable with the same wiring as my long one, meaning we connect power, the CC pins for configuration, and of course D+ and D- for the data transfer. What I got in the end was this beauty, and to check whether all wires are really at their right spots, I once again got myself another USB-C cable tester. This one is also not super cheap, but super useful when it comes to checking what USB-C standards are fulfilled and what pins of the USB-C connector are hooked up. According to that, everything seems perfect, so let's try transferring some data. And yes, that works perfectly fine. If we now switch back to my long DIY cable and try it with the tester as well, then we can see that the same standards are fulfilled and the wire assignment is also correct, but data transfer is still not possible. Now at this point, you don't have to be a genius to see the big difference between these two cables though. I mean, if we open them up, then their conductor sizes are a bit different, but I think the length of the cable plays a more important role here. To hopefully see a juicy difference though, I next firstly looked at the data pins of my short cable on the oscilloscope while transferring data. Now what we are seeing here is a differential signal, which basically means that the receiver only looks at the difference between these two signals. For example, if D+ is higher than D-, then it is a binary 1, and if D+ is lower than D-, then it is a binary 0. This method comes with the big advantage that even if there were interferences on the data lines, those would simply get ignored, because we only care about the difference. So with that in mind, let's hook up my long DIY cable and have a look at its data signals as well. And yes, I'm sadly no data signal expert, and thus not immediately see the problem here, but I think there could be two potential troublemakers. To get to the first one, let's look at longer commercial USB-C cables whose data transfer works just fine. After cutting one open, we can immediately tell that this one comes with two kinds of shielding, which my DIY one is both lacking. This shielding is important to protect the data wires from EMI, aka electromagnetic interference. And such EMI occurs when, for example, using Wi-Fi with your phone, or when pumping out current with a switched mode power supply. And usually, small interferences are not a problem due to the differential signals I talked about before. But maybe we are exceeding limits here, and thus this could be our first troublemaker. To get rid of it, we use a thin aluminium shielding that covers all wires, as well as a thicker braided shielding that comes with some gaps. Now we generally use two different types to block different frequencies of EMI. And we should also not forget to connect the shielding to ground, to basically short the COD interferences. So to find out whether shielding really makes a difference, I got myself some new cable with enough conductors that this time comes with appropriate shielding. And after cutting it to the exact same size as my long DIY USB-C cable, I soldered the wires to the breakout boards, checked whether everything was correctly in place, and did a data transfer test with my laptop, which worked perfectly fine. Awesome! After having a look at the signals with the oscilloscope, it seems like everything looks good, meaning shielding seems to be really important and should not be forgotten. So with this knowledge, are we ready for high-speed USB? To achieve that, USB moved from one differential channel that was used for sending and receiving to two differential data channels, one for sending and one for receiving. And according to the official USB documentation, it seems like we need a total of 7 wires, 2 for power, 1 for CC, aka the configuration channel, and 4 for one data channel. Another great thing about this documentation is that it also exactly tells me what pin on one side has to connect to what pin on the other side. So next I of course got myself a suitable shielded 8-wire cable, and spent way too much time trying to find a USB-C breakout board that comes with all required pins for high-speed data and an eMarker chip for power delivery. Sadly though, such a board does not exist yet, meaning I had to settle for one that features all required pins for high-speed data. After wiring two of those up, which definitely took a lot of patience and precision since the pads are very close to one another, I ended up with a cable that according to the USB tester was wired up correctly. However, no matter what I tried, the data connection never got recognized, which got me wondering whether I should have 100% followed the USB documentation and hook up D+ and D- as well, even though they get used for low-speed data transfer. So you know what, I got myself another cable with more conductors and did the soldering torture again to end up with a second attempt. This time my DIY cable did get recognized, but my laptop always used the USB 2.0 data wires instead of the USB 3.0 ones. The weird thing here though is that my DIY cable now comes with the same standards and wiring as this commercial USB 3.0 A-to-C one, that of course can perfectly fine use the USB 3.0 speed. At this point I was wondering whether my cable was still not suitable for this ridiculous high speed, and sure enough, after having another closer look at the commercial cable, it seems like each data wire pair not only comes with its own shielding, but the wires are also twisted, which might be the second troublemaker I was missing. The reason why they do this is quite complicated, but in a nutshell, it reduces EMI injection, it reduces EMI emission, and it better matches the wire impedance, and thus reduces reflections, which we might have experienced before without knowing. And a cable type that is almost perfect like described is such Ethernet Cat7 cable that you for example use for your internet. So I tried using that for my final attempt. But you probably noticed that I said almost perfect. And I said that because the conductors of this wire are stiff, and thus sadly ripped out the solder pads of my breakout boards. I did, however, had some other twisted wire laying around, that comes with a bit less shielding though. But sadly, even by using that, my cable still only got recognized as a USB 2.0 connection, meaning I have no idea what I'm doing wrong at this point, and I have to give up. But at least we learned something about data wires, and why Ethernet cable is more or less king in that regard. With that being said, I hope you enjoyed this video. If so, don't forget to like, share, subscribe, and hit the notification bell. Stay creative, and I will see you next time!